Good morning, everybody. And morning, everybody on Zoom. I'd like to lead you in the opening prayer, please. Lord of the harvest, we have gathered in, as we have gathered in your harvest, gather us in as a community in your name to worship you and be transformed by you. Gather us in, Lord. Amen. There's just one notice that I'd like to bring to your attention this week. It's the church council meeting this Wednesday at 7:30. We are going to be discussing some important things, so please, as many as you as can, do come along. I think it will be quite interesting. So, slightly odd Sunday this week, isn't it? Because we're missing most of our youngsters. They're all off enjoying themselves at 3 Gen. So, back later, bound to be very tired, but I'm sure you'll hear all about it over the coming week and next Sunday when they're in. So it just remains for me to welcome Margaret Crawshaw, who's here to join us for our service. Thank you very much.
Good morning, everyone. Good to be with you again today. As a call to worship, I'm just going to read two verses from Psalm 37, which is actually the psalm set for today. Give yourself to the Lord, trust in him, and he will help you. He will make your righteousness shine like the noonday sun. So let's praise God as we sing our first hymn, number 116. Sing for God's glory that colours the dawn of creation. Thank you to our musicians today. That sounded beautiful. And now let's pray. Creator of our world, Saviour of our souls, Guardian of our hearts, we come to you today acknowledging that we are yours. We belong to you, and in our belonging we find faith. Faith to live our lives, celebrating your goodness and faithfulness to us. Destroyer of death, giver of life, we worship you. We delight in you, in your steadfast love, in your nourishing strength, in your constant care. We adore you, our wonderful and generous God. But as we come, we know that we need to say sorry for the things we've got wrong and to ask for your forgiveness. O God, where we have considered ourselves better than we are, or more deserving than others, forgive us. Where we have forgotten the call to faithfulness and dismissed your importance in our lives, forgive us. Where we have been cynical or disregarded that which truly matters, forgive us. Give us a renewed faith today, O God. Remind us of your calling on our lives and restore us to community, we pray. Blessed be you, Lord God, for your forgiveness. This is the God who calls us, a generous and forgiving God. This is the God who redeems us, the one who made us and treasures us. This is the God who restores us, a leader worthy of our trust. And so we take a deep breath of God's grace and know that we can begin again as we go forward in renewed faith. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.
And now Steve and Sarah are going to bring us our two readings for today.
Our Old Testament reading from the book of Habakkuk, would you believe? Chapter 1, verses 1 to 4, chapter 2, verses 1 to 4 again. The prophecy that Habakkuk the prophet received. Habakkuk complains. How long, Lord, must I call for help, but you don't listen? Or cry out to you, violence, but you don't save? Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrongdoing? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteous so that justice is perverted. I will stand at my watch and station myself on the ramparts. I will look to see what he has and will say to me and what answer I am to give to this complaint. The Lord's answer. The Lord replied, write down the revelation and make it plain on tablets, so that a herald may run with it for the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end, and it will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it, and it will certainly come and will not delay. See, the enemy is puffed up. His desires are not upright. But the righteous person will live by his faithfulness. This is the word of the Lord.
Our New Testament reading is from Luke 17, chapters 5 to 10. The apostles said to the Lord, "Increase our faith." He replied, "If you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, 'Be uprooted and planted in the sea,' and it will obey you. Suppose one of you has a servant ploughing or looking after the sheep. Will he say to the servant when he comes in from the field, 'Come along now and sit down to eat'? Won't he rather say, 'Prepare my supper, get yourself ready and wait on me while I eat and drink. After that, you may eat and drink.' Will he thank the servant because he did what he was told to do? So you also, when you have done everything you were told to do, should say, 'We are unworthy servants. We have only done our duty.'" This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
We sing from Singing the Faith, number 661. "Give me the faith which can remove and sink the mountain to a plain." A significant birthday, they often celebrate by going out for a meal or maybe having a party. But when Jared and I had our last significant birthdays, which come very close together, we decided we would mark this milestone by going on a Go 8 course. For those who don't know, it's a bit like an assault course up in the treetops, where you have to jump across spaces and balance on rope bridges and go down zip wires and all that kind of stuff. I think we were trying to prove to ourselves we weren't really quite that old yet. And it was great fun, but quite early on in the course, there was you were stood on a platform and you had to jump across what felt like a significant gap to a vertical net and land on the net. And of course you had a harness and everything. But I stood there and I just froze. There's no way I can just let go and get across that thin air. And other people came past and went first, and I was still there. I tried sitting down, that was no better. And in the end, I just had to close my eyes and launch myself. And I did get there, obviously, because I'm here. But I knew in theory I couldn't fall to the ground because I had the safety harness on, I was attached to something. But it was just so hard to let go and trust myself that I would land on that net. I actually got a round of applause when I did it. They'd been waiting so long for me. And that must have been one of the scariest things I've ever done. So don't ever ask me to jump out of a plane or anything. I think it's just not an easy thing to do, to have enough faith to launch yourself into something that feels challenging or even impossible. And that seems to be where the disciples are at when we meet them in that reading from Luke. That reading feels like Jesus is giving the disciples quite a hard time. At the beginning of the chapter, the bit we didn't hear, he's been warning them to take care that they don't cause anyone to fall into sin by their words or their behaviour. Scary thing, scary thought. And then he's told them they've got to keep on forgiving anyone who wrongs them, even as many as 7 times in a day. In other words, forever, really. And perhaps they're feeling they're just not up to this. They aren't sure they've got enough confidence and faith to be able to do what Jesus wants of them and be the example he wants them to be to others. And they ask him to increase their faith. But, of course, and typically, really, Jesus doesn't do what they ask. He doesn't say, yes, you do need to have more faith. Here you are, have more faith. Then you'll be all right. Instead, he seems to be saying, don't waste your time wishing you had greater faith or thinking you can't do anything until you've got more resources. Just get on with what I'm telling you to do with what you've got. It's like he turns the question of faith away from an issue of quantity to one of sufficiency. Even the tiniest amount of faith, the size of a mustard seed, is enough to get them started on doing kingdom things. And then just to make sure they don't get too full of themselves, he adds, and don't expect any reward or special treatment, you know, for doing it. After all, you are simply God's servants and doing what's expected of you. So, I think Jesus' message to us, as to the disciples really, is that we mustn't let ourselves be paralysed by the size of the task. It's so easy, especially at the moment it feels, to look at the state of the world or the state of our country and feel helpless or despairing. It's often easy just to look around us at our domestic situation or community and think, what can I possibly do? But there is always something we can do, however small. When we see a need or we sense there's something God wants us to do, Sometimes we just have to take a deep breath and have a go. There's no need to wait until we're totally confident about it, or we can see the whole way ahead. All we need is one tiny step of faith to get started. And in fact, throughout Luke's Gospel, faith isn't simply a question of belief in or certainty about someone or something. I guess we could always all do with more certainty, that kind of faith. But it's always faith linked to action. It shows itself in a variety of ways, in a willingness to take risks. For example, when those fishermen respond to Jesus telling them to push out into deep water and let down their nets for a catch, and they do it. It shows itself in courage and persistence in reaching out across social or physical barriers, like when that group of men are so determined to bring their paralyzed friend to Jesus that they make a hole in the roof of the house where Jesus is and let him down in front of him. It shows itself in love, like when that unnamed woman pours her precious perfume over Jesus' feet. It's not so much about having a certain quantity of faith as how we respond in faith to situations we find ourselves in. That passage we heard from Habakkuk may not seem to have much connection with the gospel reading, although it certainly has a contemporary ring to it. Across 2.5 millennia, we see the prophet looking around at the breakdown of society, the destruction, the violence, the perversion of justice. And we hear him crying out to God, "How long must I call for help before you listen? How can you endure to look on such wrongdoing?" And I'm sure many people around the world are echoing those words right now. And God's only response is that there is still a vision which will be fulfilled, but Habakkuk and his people must be faithful while they wait for it. And in line with what we've seen in Luke's gospel, maybe that doesn't just mean believing and trusting and passively waiting, but also persevering in doing what good they can while they wait, for the sake of all those who are suffering. In a world where it often appears that the lawless and godless come out on top, it can be tough to live in faith and faithfulness. That little group of disciples would have been the first to say that being a follower of Christ isn't an easy option. They often found Jesus' expectations of them hard to bear. They had to keep on acknowledging that they'd failed him. And yet they knew that trusting him and trying to follow him was the most important thing in the world. In a world every bit as unsettling and full of suffering as Habakkuk's world, every bit as confusing and painful as our world today, it was what gave sense and purpose to their lives. Justice can take a long time to come, but as we try to live faithfully and pass our faith on to others who come after us, the small, ordinary acts of goodness and justice that we do each day, we really can move mountains and change the world little by little into a place where God's kingdom is revealed. So let us be steadfast in our faith. however feeble it may feel at times, and ready to put it into action in obedience to Christ's call. And we may be amazed by the results. I want to finish with a prayer by Pat Bennett. Let's pray. Jesus, you were faithful to yourself, to your task, to your vision of God's kingdom. In the small daily ordinariness of embodied humanity, as well as in the larger extraordinariness of incarnated deity, may we too be faithful, wherever we are and to whatever we have been called, both in the everyday ordinary and the perhaps sometimes extraordinary. Amen. And so we sing hymn number 662, which I think is a rather wonderful new hymn by Jacqueline Jones. Have you heard God's voice? Has your heart been stirred? Are you still prepared to follow? Now we come to our prayers of concern. Let us pray. May it not be long, Lord. May it not be long before the world we pray for and the world we inhabit are one. May it not be long before the domination of wealth over want, white over black, man over woman, the privileged over the poor, are facts of history, not facts of life. May it not be long, Lord, before the earth no longer suffers through human selfishness, so that the valleys can sing again, the meadows laugh, and barren places burst into bloom. May it not be long, Lord, before economic power comes only with accountability, and money and taxation are wedded to just purposes. May it not be long, Lord, before we vacate the safe refuges of pessimism and cynicism and find wells of hope deeper than shallow pools of optimism. May it not be long, Lord, before we feel ourselves directly addressed by your voice, as those first disciples did, and respond in faithful action. May it not be long, Lord. And as we reflect on this past week, we pray for support for all those affected by floods in Pakistan or tornadoes in Cuba and Florida. We pray for wisdom for our government as the pound tumbles on foreign markets and people fear what this winter may bring. We pray for your comfort and peace for those who are anxious or ill or have lost loved ones. We pray for the young people who've gone from Cary to 3GEM and for all the young people gathered there, that they might have a fun-filled, encouraging and faith-enhancing time together. And finally, we pray with open doors, praising you that in Syria, partners have been able to provide hundreds of microloans to help families start their own businesses. We pray that these loans may restore people's dignity and enable them to provide for their families. Lord, we bring these and all the prayers of our hearts in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And we join together in the prayer Jesus gave us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. God offers God's peace to each and to all. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And your spirit.
Our communion hymn is number 581, and while we're singing, the offering will be taken. So we sing number 581, Come, My Table is the Meeting Place. Bring to you bread and wine for our communion, lives and gifts for your kingdom, all for transformation through your love and grace. Amen. God of space and starry skies, of rainforests, ocean depths, and the feathered wings of dove, we praise you for your creative power and your steadfastness. You guided the prophets of old, calling them to trust you and to speak your urgent word to your people. You sent your Son Jesus to reveal your love, challenge our assumptions, and teach us to act in faith. You empower us now through your Holy Spirit when we are willing to trust you for the way ahead. As we gather as your people, we remember how on the night before he died, Jesus sat at supper with his friends. He took the bread, gave you thanks, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant. Do this in remembrance of me." So, through the power of your Spirit, may these ordinary things of bread and wine be for us the body and blood of Christ. Amen. Christ, the bread of life, broken for the world. Before we draw near, we just pray for those who are joining us by Zoom, that they might know Christ's presence with them, upholding and strengthening, comforting and healing, and bringing his peace. Amen. So let us draw near in faith, for it is Christ who invites us. Stay together.
We thank you, Lord, for sharing with us the food and drink of heaven. Strengthened for service, may we have enough faith to do as you command, until the earth more nearly sets end to your kingdom. In the name of your Son, our Lord and Saviour, Jesus Christ.
Final hymn this morning is number 547. Beyond these walls of worship, in the stress and joy of life, can we offer you our bodies as a living sacrifice? And he asks, will we turn to you, be transformed by you, still declare you God of all?
Thank you.
Lord, we know that your kingdom exists wherever injustice is challenged, wherever the hungry are fed, wherever the helpless are helped. Help us to work faithfully for this, wherever we are this week. And may the blessing of God, creator, redeemer, and inspirer, rest upon us all and those we love, now and always. Amen.